I need to definitely watch more anime like reviewers and stuff. I feel like at least like that being said, on my personal like account, I probably have way more feeds of like this kind of stuff. This is exactly what I'm talking about. I want to see more feeds like this. Mother's Basement, is a great Joey. So let's watch Mother's Basement. I actually haven't seen a video, a Mother's Basement video in a while. This was about a month ago, so not too old. Let's check it out, my dude. It'll be the first time we react to Mother's Basement on the channel too. So let's do it. I actually am. I'm not a huge. Like I haven't been like super on top of it, but lately, especially now that I've been getting more and more into the later animes, I've been watching a lot more Mother's Basement. Freaking love it. Let's go ahead and subscribe live on stream. Please go subscribe to Mother's Basement. Great, amazing content, dude, it's phenomenal. And then, of course, like it, drop an AO in the chat, or even better, drop a fire emote and a monkey emote next to each other. He'll know.
To say that Oshinoko blew up on arrival,
but just in case, tell him I said you. Oz Monkey said
we're talking tens of thousands of tweets, the most successful premiere ever for High Dive, the most underrated anime streaming platform.
P.S. I'm sure if there are spoilers, we'll go into spoiler talks towards the end of the video itself. So, but yeah, for the most part, I gotta admit, I did really enjoy that first episode, dude. It was phenomenal.
Platform ever, one of the highest scoring debuts in my.
And I genuinely do like the relationship of teenage like these two dudes, the brother and sister like dynamic. How he's like super overprotective, trying to make sure that she's safe, and like he doesn't even know her real identity, like of her previous life, you know. So it's like really cool to be able to see a little bit of that overprotectiveness on his part, not even knowing yet, like, you know, the whole secret identity. So it's really cool. I like that whole aspect.
My anime listery history.
I can't wait to see that. And I actually really like that, like the anime that we just saw, the freaking the F1 race car one. I freaking love her character too. She's really cool. She's really really cool. I like how she was like a snotty brat.
That's
and like
right. Not Oricon.
Full on change like towards the later
also
on.
Also Oricon. Kind of goes really without cool. Saying it'd be number one in Japan, but for a minute. Idol by Yo Asobi was the biggest song in the entire world, excluding America. The first anime theme or Japanese song.
Of course, dude, this freaking, like, baby, like, I freaking love this. This meme right here, this little, like, scene, segment, the entire reason why I watched the anime, flat out.
Period.
I love this whole little, like animation of the babies dancing. So cute.
Was the biggest song in the entire world, excluding America. The first anime theme or Japanese song period to ever claim that title. So, given the huge impact this anime has had, both on the community and me personally.
I'm so jealous of this guy. Look at this ramp. Y'all see this red figure in the back? I wanted this red figure with the green, like, sun dress. It was so cute. I thought it was the most adorable thing ever. But I have, like, three red figures already. I can't buy a fourth. Or can I?
I wanted to take a look back at the whole first season. Now that
I should.
To see
you're
if
right.
It held up and...
You've convinced me, chat. I should buy another one. The main issue was drop in quality from the first episode. I can see that, and again, I it's probably because I'm only like two or three episodes in. He said get it. I can definitely see if people are like not a fan of like the drop in quality for sure. I guess I will make my own decision like once I actually watch it to that point. But that's why I kind of want to like just sort of get people's opinions on stuff, you know, see what they're saying, see what they're doing. There's actually a major reason why I haven't been watching a whole lot of anime reviews live on stream or reacting to stuff like this. And honestly, a lot of it is I didn't really want to watch other people's reviews because, you know, I'm working on writing Anime Addict with Degenerate Weeb, you know, so it's kind of like we wanted to avoid getting too influenced by other people's content, if you get what I'm saying. But now that we kind of have the gist of what the show is going to be, we got it really planned out and everything, I'm starting to feel more comfortable in watching other reviewers, watching other anime creator content, and not being afraid of, like, getting influenced too much or changing my style, quote-unquote, for something, you know, that they're doing. I'm not saying that it's bad if you like try to learn from somebody else's videos or you know, try to adapt something that you saw from somebody else doing it. Like, that's there's nothing really wrong with that. But I just want to try to, like, you know, sort of shimmy in my own little unique flavor, you know, on the my little twist on the genre, so to speak. So we're that's why we've been sort of neglecting watching a whole lot of reviews and other anime content lately, I'll be honest.
Figure out why. What about this concept and the way it's executed has made it resonate so widely and so deeply?
Honestly, is this anime the plot really the good? You know, spoiler alerts, I'm not gonna spoil too hard, I'm just sort of gonna insinuate, like, that big plot twist, that big, like, moment, so to speak, with the mom, like, that thing really hit, that hit. Like, I can definitely see that grabbing a lot of people's attention and bringing them into the anime and really holding them throughout, because they genuinely made a really, really charismatic and really heartwarming character in that mom. I also feel like the fact that she was, at least by Western standards, she was an underage single mom. Like, we don't know who the dad is, you know? It brings a little bit of extra air of, like, I don't know, taboo-ness to the whole scenario, you know what I mean?
Spoiler alert. Yes. And if it is...
So we got people... It got a lot of people's attention. People like to talk smack about taboo subjects and, like, be like, taboo this, taboo that. But then they like to snuggle into their little, you know, comfy chairs and be like, yeah, I'm comfy here. But suddenly, you know, you gotta... You know, like, so it's... People like to watch a show. They like to watch like little taboo things. You know, it's like dramas. People say they don't want drama, but that yet there's an entire genre based on TV shows specifically intended to bring as much drama as humanly possible.
What makes it so damn good? Which also happens to be a convenient excuse to wax philosophical once more on the fantastic writing of Aka Akasaka, creator of Kaguya-sama: Love is War.
Okay, I thought the name was familiar. I'll be honest with everyone here. It's not even necessarily that it's a Japanese name thing. I am terrible at names, period. Like, no matter what. Spanish, English, Japanese, French. I am terrible at names in any instance. And when you put in first and last names, it gets even worse for me. And since in Japanese culture, for the most part, you use both first and last names, you know, it becomes very difficult for me. But yeah, Aka Akasaka, actually, genuinely, I'm not even a fan of romance comedies or rom-coms or any of that stuff. Love is War, absolutely a great anime. I'm a few episodes into the third season, into Love is War, ultra romantic. Love it so far. Chika, best girl. My favorite character in the whole anime so far. I love Chika and the dude who's always depressed. My favorite two characters.
Anime I love thinking about so much.
Great anime,
absolutely. An actual movie about it. But I promise both you guys and my editors,
maybe we'll check it out someday.
This video get quite that out of hand.
No, do it. Y'all have to understand something. I am such a... I love with such... passion. I love long format content. It is I don't know. I just love it. I love when people make long, big size. Like, I have probably watched the YMS Lion King documentary. His YMS Lion King video. It's like 5 hours long. I've probably watched it like 3 or 4 times at this point, I think. Honestly, like, no lie, I fall asleep to that YMS Lion King Kimba the White Lion review.
Both
the Lion King and the Kimba the White Lion review.
I accidentally make a whole bonus analysis video of the opening credits over on my second channel, Basement Life. That's separate content. It's healthy. I'm just looking for a more manageable way to bring back what's an LP.
If there's one thing, if there's definitely one thing I would have loved is if we had, I'm so sorry, I can't remember her name, but the main girl, the mom, if they didn't, like, to pull the whole situation on for episode 1, maybe if they waited till episode 2, or even episode 3, and then, you know, made the fan, you know, do what he did, I think it would have even made it even an even stronger anime. I'll be completely honest with you. It would have lured people in more with all the drama, you know, trying to figure out, like, who's the dad? I think it would have worked. Even second episode would have worked. Because I think if you did three episodes, it wouldn't have been enough story to honestly, like, stretch it. But I feel like if you did it on second episode, did they even do it on second episode? How many episodes am I in? Now that I got to think about it, right? Correct me if I am wrong. Give me smack. It's been like a week since I've watched the anime. I gotta catch up. But yeah, no, I feel like if they didn't change quite so drastically into a whole different setting, all new characters, because they really hammered home the mom, and you really wanted to see more of the mom. So to take away a character like that, it can be off-putting to a lot of people. It's similar to, like, Game of Thrones. A lot of people that I knew, and not only Game of Thrones and Attack on Titan, actually. A lot of people that I knew that, like, dropped the anime, it was because of, like, the some of those earlier death scenes in those shows, where they were like, I love that character too much, I don't want to watch any more of Derrick-Han. But then they came back eventually, because they were cut, you know, the story was good. Well, I mean, yeah, that character is gone, but now what about these characters? Well, how are they going to react to it, you know? And so I feel like if they would have played a little bit more with that, maybe more people would have, like, followed it through all the way to the end. Not saying that it wasn't popular or that it didn't get a lot of views. I'm just saying, I'm going based off of the criticisms I've been hearing.
Obsessed? You're obsessed. Look, I'll prove it by doing a criticism. If I have one complaint about Oshinoko, it's that High Dive neglected to subtitle P.A.On's workout song in episode 5, which is...
Okay, I saw episode 5. 100% I saw episode 5. So all this
isn't exactly the end.
I'm on at least episode 5.
Vital, but there is some humor and character building in there that
freaking love this scene. Oh, it's the best scene in the whole anime.
I think most fans
look at this Giga Chad
to have missed.
Yeah.
Thankfully, today's video part.
I'll be honest with you.
Isn't exactly the end of the world.
I'll be completely honest with you.
But there is some humor and character building in there that
out of context, if I were to play this right here, right now from here,
I think most fans would prefer
to
not
here.
To have missed.
You would think you were on the Orange YouTube. Shut your mouth and just accept reality here. Let's not kid ourselves.
Thankfully, today's video partner has a simple solution to that problem. All you gotta do is learn Japanese. Okay, obvious.
Actually, genuine question for anyone and everyone who watches the VODs in the future as well. And this is, like, not only for now, but probably for Fridays in the future as well. Would y'all be down to learn Japanese with me? Like, full on, just, I'm just gonna load up Duolingo, like, the website, the free language learning thing, and we're just gonna learn Japanese for, like, 4 hours every Friday. And that's it. I'm just gonna learn Japanese with y'all. There's nothing else. I'm not gonna do nothing else. Just chill out with me, learn Japanese.
Obviously, that's...
I gotta prepare. Eventually, me, Degenerate Weeb, and Chaos, and who knows who else, hopefully Burrito, we're all gonna go to Japan one of these days. So I gotta start practicing, you know?
A little easier said than done, but maybe not as much as you'd expect with the power of Rosetta Stone on your side. Rosetta Stone is a pioneering language learning...
I mean, yes, Rosetta Stone. Please, go sign up for Rosetta Stone using Mother's Basement's link. That's totally Duo, what oh? Why would you get that stuff when you could get Rosetta Stone? Forget I said the other stuff.
Alike, for its intuitive and immersive method. Instead of drilling you on vocabulary
intuitive,
in your
yes.
tongue, Rosetta Stone will have you speaking exclusively in Japanese
yeah.
day one.
Teaching day
you
one, day
the
one.
The sounds you're making directly with the...
I feel like you're overestimating how intelligent of a monkey I am.
...images and concepts they...
I can barely figure English out. And I'm pretty sure that was my first language.
...represent, as well as the characters that represent those sounds. The same way we both learned the words I'm saying now. Rosetta Stone focuses on teaching you...
Yeah, I don't know the way I learned these words I'm saying now. I kind of just figured it out as I went.
Practical...
I was a baby.
...conversational language, and their voice recognition feature helps you practice your pronunciation so any potential conversation partners will understand you as you gush about your favorite anime and idols the same...
How do I say what it do, baby, in Japanese?
Anyway, you'll now understand those things' dialogue and lyrics. And with the app on mobile and lessons as short as 10 minutes, you can learn all that whenever and wherever you have time. And I do mean whenever, as in throughout your whole life. Because right now, exclusively for you basement dwellers, Rosetta Stone is offering life...
I need a cool freaking, like, community name. Like the whole thing is that I am the captain of this spaceship. The Flamethrower Monkey is our spaceship. The H-E-R, her elegancies ride. Flamethrower Monkey, that is our spaceship. I am the captain. You are all my crew. But I don't know what to actually call y'all. I wanted to go with something like I don't know. Like, we could go with crewmates, but I want something cooler. Something nicer. Something that's, like, quick and easy and spunky. Yeah, something spunky. My little spunk boys.
Time subscriptions for a whopping 50% off.
He has basement dwellers. That's freaking sick. I love it.
At partners.rosettastone.com/mothersbasement/mb1.
Like, I'd be fine with just calling y'all crew. My crew. Rolling with the crew. But, I kind of want to, like, you know, I wanted to go with something more monkey-based as opposed to space-based, you know? Even though I am supposed to be, like, a space monkey.
And that $150 doesn't just get you Japanese. It opens up all 25 Rosetta Stone languages, so you can keep...
Space monkey.
Keep using this incredible tool to expand your mind and your world no matter where life takes you in the future. All you gotta do is click the link below to start that journey today.
What if life takes me to the gutter?
Right.
I'll be able to ask for money in multiple languages.
I guess that was more a criticism of the localization than the anime itself. Also, it was a very mild criticism. Also, it was more of a segue into an ad spot than a...
Isn't a Spike Spiegel figure? Nice. It's a good one.
Actual criticism. But
I just noticed the tiny little Tony Chopper in the back, too. Sorry, I'm so distracted by your background.
I think I proved my point.
Don't think I didn't notice that dope-ass Rasputin in the back. With his brain, I love it, from Psychonauts.
Now let's start figuring out why so many people love this anime so much. The first secret to Oshinoko's success is no secret at all, really. Given the attention it grabbed and buzz it generated, you can make a very strong, non-hyperbolic argument that this anime has the best, or at least most effective, first episode
Absolutely.
Of all time.
Most definitely. 100%, 110% agree. The... tragic episode, first episode, is an absolute attention grabber. Like I said, I fully understand if that very first episode quite literally hooked people throughout the entire anime season, even despite all the criticisms. I could totally see that one first episode, and it really drives home just how important, I feel like it really drives home just how incredibly important it is to make sure that you make a good first impression on your first episode. I can't remember who I recently saw, and if I do find that clip again, because I haven't finished the whole video, maybe we can watch it. I fully disagree with this notion of, like, you have to watch the first three episodes. Well, you can't drop the anime. You have to watch the first three episodes. You gotta give it a chance. You didn't even give it a chance. How? What? You can't drop Black Clover. It gets good after episode 64 when Asta like he yells even louder after episode 50. You know, like, you can't tell. I promise, Asta shuts up after episode 74. Trust. He stops yelling. I swear. Like, you get what I'm saying? Nah, forget all that. Even the whole, like, nah, you gotta watch the first three episodes. You gotta at least watch the first three episodes. Like, no, I don't. You either get me on episode one, or I'm not watching episode two. Screw you. Like, why do I owe you three episodes? Entertain me. Isn't that the whole point? Screw that. You said the opening song got you? The opening song was absolutely amazing as well. I can absolutely see that opening song being in every single DJ at every single anime expo after party for years to come. I can definitely see that, 100%. And I'm surprised I haven't been nonstop repeat listening to remixed versions of the song, like, lately, honestly.
Well, first movie might be more accurate. Not only is it feature length, but the premiere even enjoyed a theatrical run in Japan 2 weeks ahead of the show's debut.
To a certain degree, my point stands, but is also corrected. It was a rather long first episode. So in reality, it's probably like four episodes in one. Three or four episodes in one, I guess, depending on your standards, time-wise, that is. So yeah, about an hour long episode. I can see that broken down into about three or four episodes, and I guess that is fair. But of course, as far as anyone else is concerned, that was the first episode, that was the attention grabber, that's what got people. That's why I said, like, I feel like maybe if they drew it out a little bit more, potentially they could have hooked more people on. Or not hooked more people on, but I think they would have alleviated some of the criticisms of it dropping in quality after the first episode, if they would have split that into two episodes, you get me? Just to sort of like say, like, no, we put more effort into it, you know, than just one big episode.
Special recap episode.
But I can also see that becoming a problem, because, you know, I do really, really love the fact that they just sort of said, look, there's a lot you gotta know before. Like, there's too much information to relay to you before we begin the actual main plot of the anime, so we're just gonna do a big movie for the first episode. I can agree to that. I think Darwin's Game did the same thing, and while that one I wasn't as much of a fan of, I still do believe that it was a pretty good way of doing it. The first episode being a feature-length film, effectively.
Calls unprecedented in anime history.
Really sort of gets Jimmy Neutron across the whole point, you know?
Still, Oshinoko almost certainly did it best, with a film that serves not just as a strong, self-contained introduction to the world and characters, but essential setup for its central mystery and drama, allowing it to fill the same hype generation.
I'll admit, flat out, I feel like one thing that held back this anime, big time, held it back, again, is the fact that she's 16 years old in this anime. And the vast majority of Andes, like just everyday Andy, like anime Andes that I see, like they're not comfortable with that. Flat out. Let's not beat around the bush, right? Like, I'm not about to sit here and pretend like I'm some almightier than thou freaking stance. At the end of the day, we all know what this is, and we enjoy and appreciate, like, you know, the culture and the hilarious memes that we say, like we meme about lollies and all this other stuff. But there are certain points where we get into like age, especially legal, like the legal age of consent and all that, that it starts to get really, really, really like down to like some people are just flat out uncomfortable with that stuff. So the fact that the story was like this 16-year-old mom
writing role in anime,
you know,
form that the first volume of
that's also an idol.
The manga did by killing off its apparent protagonist 3 months into the series run in Weekly Young Jump. But I think it simply wouldn't have worked in the anime for two key reasons. First, spoilers would.
I'm glad to see that. See, so in the Weekly Jump, it was a weekly thing. They were not. You get me? Like, the whole storyline of the mom was more spaced out. So they were able to like get the most what I guess what I'm trying to say is the part of the manga that had to hit the hardest at your heartstrings hit the hardest. It did what it was supposed to do. It accomplished its mission. But in the adaptation to the anime, they had to do it in one episode, you know? In one long episode in order to, like, fit the whole thing. So I can, you know, I feel like that was to its detriment.
Already have been out there for any viewers curious enough to look in the weeks it would have taken the anime to get there, removing the shock factor completely. And secondly, those first 3 to 4 episodes wouldn't have much of a hook beyond.
I did have the death scene spoiled for me. Didn't ruin it at all. It was such a good, it was such a well-played scene, such an emotional, heartbreaking scene, especially when I won't spoil this, but especially after what the mom tells the murderer. Like before she goes down, I'm like, oh, dude, like, you're a piece of shit. You get what I'm saying?
This idol story,
you're a doo-doo.
Oh,
you're an absolute doo-doo face.
Side of the industry, which has been done in anime before. Package all that up in a real good feel-bad movie, though, and suddenly, instead of a...
I love the absolute, like, contrast. Or not contrast. It wouldn't be contrast, but the... the mirroring. I love how here in this particular scene, the girl who wants to become an idol in the future, she's being sheltered, and like the brother and the mom are effectively hiding her away and keeping her from seeing the ugly real world of the idol industry. So she's locked away in this room. She's being kept away from that brutal reality of the idol world. Whereas the kid, the son, is on the other side with the mom, seeing all the blood, seeing all the dark side of the of like the idol world. You get what I'm saying? So it's like really cool, like little like, I don't know, dude. The writer's so good. You could tell it was the writer of Love Is War. Like, so good, so good.
Month long commitment to a show you're not sure. And
little nuances like that, where like you know, I don't know. It gets like it's those things that I notice, and I'm just like, oh, it's setting it up because you know, I'm definitely one of those nerds that like you jangle some keys in front of me, and I go, keys jingling, you know. I definitely, yeah, as soon as I saw this scene, I was like, oh, it's like it's a metaphor for the adventure they're gonna go on when they grow up.
Could have fallen off of. You've got this singular viewing event that
I have to admit, all these scenes of her being a mom, so cute, so adorable.
Like
I loved
myself,
it
myself could freak out and shout, yo, go see this thing without looking up anything about, and then you'd go do that, and because you know the runtime, instead of getting bored waiting for the plot to happen, you actually
she also has one of my absolutely favorite character designs,
character
and color schemes.
Inability
look
to
at that, that's so cute.
Feelings,
love her.
Which proves to be her greatest strength as an idol.
I simp. I fully simp.
Ensures that ending will hit you like a knife to the gut, and then when Aqua vows to find her true killer in the end,
yeah.
Not only do you
I freaking love Aqua, this kid's dope. Look at this!
You get to enjoy the distinctly anime hype of, wow, look at this handsome young man about to go do terrible things.
Yeah, I was about to say, some real Light Yagami freaking vibes, like full Light Yagami vibes. I love it! I love how he's just like, yes, I'll become an actor so I can get closer and then kill him. Like, he's so, like, ready to do it. I'm like, and I'm not, like, of course, we should all, we're a Christian channel here. We should all be trying to become the best people that we possibly can. We need to become pacifists. Eat only vegan foods so that only no animals will get hurt. And we have to be nice to everyone and make sure that everyone gets hugs and kisses every morning. But I want him to murder that man. I want to see him suffer. I want to see the light fade from his eyes. Oh, man. I love it. It really draws you in. Aqua, like, the way that Aqua is written, it really draws you in. I frankly don't care at all about the idol stuff. But this dude, Aqua, like the whole journey of him, like having to get into the industry, and like just something about like the idea of like this guy's making, he's building relationships, he's becoming famous, he's doing like all this stuff, knowing full well that at any moment he'll just have to like he's just gonna have to cap a dude. And then he's gonna lose all of it, go to jail forever. He doesn't care. He doesn't mind. Like that's such villain vibes, my dude. That's such villain vibes. Oh my goodness. Oh, you just love to see it. It's like watching Tyrion Lannister back when he was the quote unquote evil like team. You know, technically. It's like yeah. Keep doing what you're doing. Yeah.
Terrible people, but also emotionally speaking. You understand where he's coming from and completely want to root for him and his quest for vengeance.
Love
because
him.
You also
get that man. You get him. You get that.
Don't really care about I, even if you've been around the storytelling block enough.
Oh, I freaking love the director. The director's such a freaking dope dude. He's my one of my favorites. I love him. I love everything about the director. I love that he still lives with his mom. I love the freaking it's the funniest thing.
It's such a strong setup that it ironically set the show up for a degree of failure too. There was simply no way the episode-to-episode viewing experience could really match the concentrated intensity of that first roller coaster ride, especially not when the mystery it hooks you on proves to be something of a slow burner. So some disappointment for at least some viewers was inevitable, and it was equally inevitable that some of that disappointment would
like, Like, y'all gotta understand something, bros. Like, this at this whole segment here, this whole, like, episode, like, this whole, like, I don't even know, scene? Yeah, this whole scene here that we saw Aqua calling the director, like, hey, why you putting my mom in, like, a B-rate movie? Like, what you doing? Like, flat out, my dude, like, I would have watched this anime. If she just never, like, if the whole twist of her getting, like, spoilers again, major spoilers this time, I'm just gonna flat out say it, alright? If the whole twist of her getting murdered didn't happen, oh, flat out, my dude, full on, I would've kept watching this anime of just watching these two adorable kids, like, navigating the world, the Hollywood world, wanting their mom to get, like, better reincarnated, you know? Like, that was it, I would've watched it. Full on, without the murder mystery
against any aspect of it. Such insanely,
I love the character. It was really well written, you know?
A very potent blend of haterade. Oh, hey, look! The guy who mocked a YouTuber for his brother's death wrote a novel feigning outrage about the show's portrayal of online harassment.
I'm getting the feeling there's some history here. and I'm just going to say, first impressions. Let's find out what this is about.
Oh, hey, look! The guy who mocked a YouTuber for his brother's death wrote a novel feigning outrage about the show's portrayal of online harassment. And it's the second most liked Oshinoko review on MAL! Of course, that
is in
the context of what's still the 15th highest rated anime on the whole site, and the 5th highest non-sequel, so clearly the haters are a minority there. But they're a vocal one whose complaints are probably worth acknowledging, if only to...
Yeah, apparently, because they're very vocal, because they had me over here thinking, like, a lot of people had an issue with the anime. Come to find out, it's being received really, really well, and I'm like, oh, cool, I'm glad. It was a great, great, amazing first episode. And I'm still enjoying it, 5 episodes in, I guess, or whatever I am.
Dismiss most of them. Like, yeah, if you come off that last 5 minutes of movie expecting the next Death Note, the rest of the show won't leave you very satisfied, but there's way more movie there than those last 5 minutes, and the complete package promises quite a bit more, all of which the show makes good on, such as the character-driven comedy that Aka Akasaka is already very...
You love this woman, she's the best.
Very well known for, plus the potent escapist fantasy of watching nobodies become superstars, seen both in how the twins are reincarnated with the looks, skills, and connections to break into showbiz, and in Ai's story of going from the orphanage to the Budokan. And then, of course, there's the drama that's born from that fantasy crashing up against the unfair reality of the Japanese entertainment industry. A world of creative compromise built on convenient lies and ulterior motives, where politics and the almighty yen...
It gets... If you guys have ever watched a documentary on the idol scene in Japan, on the agencies, the brutal, brutal... And I'm sure it's no secret. People, everyone in the world has seen stuff like this. You know, there was some of these poor idols, some of these poor agency, like, clients or models, agents, I don't know what you would call them. Like, they genuinely, like, do you guys remember that one girl who, I guess it turned out that she had secretly been seeing a boyfriend? And I guess, like, the agency was gonna fire her, like, it becomes such a big deal, the fans were all mad, she wasn't allowed to have a boyfriend, so of course, everyone got so pissed off, she actually genuinely had to go on, like, I don't know if it was, like, what social media it was, but she shaved her hair, apologized for having a boyfriend, all so she could attempt to get back into the group, back into the agency. It was brutal, and I feel like a lot of these agencies are very abusive. They take advantage of a lot of these models, these idols, and I think it's a much deeper, darker, like, underground scene, and you have to remember, like, again, it comes back to that same, like, what I said earlier, I, in that instance, was 16, so it's a lot of 16-year-olds being placed into very, very, very bad, like, not bad, but necessarily, but very, very compromising positions, very, very... sketchy situations at such a young age. Me personally, I was an idiot. I don't think I would have been able to navigate the vast majority of any of this stuff very well. To this day, I don't, like, half the things I see on media, movies, TV shows, animes, like whatever it is, I'm like, how do these freaking kids do? When I was their age, I was freaking, I couldn't kick a rock half a mile, like down half a mile without freaking stumbling over myself and freaking getting a concussion or something. I don't know. Like, whatever. Anyway, moving on. I'm rambling.
And trump all else, and artists have to fight tooth and nail to make their voices heard. All for an audience that demands they bury their humanity in those lies while paradoxically expecting to find something authentic to connect with in their work.
I am incredibly, incredibly happy that this anime, more than anything, started to bring to light a lot more the conversation of parasocial relationships, especially on YouTube. And it's definitely one of those things that you definitely need to be fully aware of and think about if you want to become a VTuber, if you want to start doing any VTubing, or just YouTube in general. Honestly, you absolutely need to keep that in mind. Parasocial relationships can be incredibly dangerous, can be incredibly scary and unhealthy. And you know what? It's as good a time as any to mention stuff like this. There always needs to be a very distinct separation between, like, audience and creator. Like, you guys have to understand something. I think you're all awesome. Like, I chat up anybody out in the streets. I think I try to be nice to everyone I meet, no matter who it is. So if you guys just turn up in my chat and want to hang out with me, like, that's basically what it is. You guys, like, we're strangers, but you guys are showing up to my chat. You're here to support me, and we're just gonna hang out and chill. Like, unfortunately, it's a one-way street as far as, like, all I can do is entertain you from here, and, you know, I can only see you as far as words go on the chat, stuff like that. You know, so there is that disconnect, but, you know, I feel like as long as everyone understands that there is that sort of separation of, like, hey, I don't know you personally, but I definitely know you as far as, like, you know, on this setting, the stream setting. I know you on this as a part of this community that we're all a part of. And there's a big difference between, oh, I know someone in that community, in the, you know, I know somebody in the Markiplier community. I know somebody in the Mother's Basement community. There's a big difference between knowing someone in Mother's Basement's community, whether it is, you know, Mother's Basement himself, or it is just another audience member as well. Like, you know them as part of the community. You don't know them on a personal level, and you need to understand that and sort of keep those boundaries well established. And, you know, I wish I was more opinionated on the whole, like, is it on the creators to make sure that doesn't happen, yada yada. It's like, I don't know if it's on the creators or on the audience or on the platform or on whoever. I don't know who it's on. I just know that if the creators keep it in mind and, you know, actively try to avoid situations like that, and if the audience keeps it in mind and actively tries to avoid, you know, building an unhealthy relationship with a creator that they watch, and I believe if the platform also keeps it in mind and tries to set up rules that could help navigate these kinds of situations, you know, I feel like if everybody just sort of put in a little bit of effort, we would be in a much better situation all around instead of just pointing fingers. You know what I mean? So that's my take on that. There you go. Hot takes with Flamethrower Monkey. I mean, Oz the Monkey. Ignore that last one. Play.
Oshinoko is about the contradiction and interplay between the glitz and glamour of the spotlight and the darkness that lurks behind the scenes. The latter aspect coming through in Aqua's story of schmoozing his way from set to set, tracking down clues in the mystery of the twins' father, while the former is embodied in Ruby and her unshaken aspiration to become an idol in the spitting...
Am I the only one? I don't care if this comes off as simpy or whatever. Am I the only one who also was kind of like, I kind of want to know who's the guy who got a 16-year-old pregnant and just sort of left her with twins, like, and then I guess what, told on her and got her killed? Like, what a prick! Like, I'm just saying.
Of their late mother, who Douche. Herself was the very embodiment of that contradiction. An idol yearning to find her truth in the lies her job demanded of her, who finally found the secret to connecting with her fans in a secret she could never, ever tell them. I understand wanting to chase the high of those last 5 minutes, wishing the show could ditch the comedy and idle fantasies to go all in those all-according-to-Keikaku vibes that it does very well, but I think that would seriously diminish what makes Oshinoko great, and not just because I'm personally a big fan of how Akasaka writes comedy. I do think that both Kaguya-sama and this show prove he has the chops to write something that's pure Machiavellian mind games.
Yeah, this, if anything, has absolutely put, I'm so sorry, I'm freaking messing up. Akasa, like, this has just absolutely goaded him, in my opinion. Like major, major goaded this dude. Like, I'm gonna be excited for anything and everything involving him now. Because this absolutely, like, after, as someone who's, like, you have to understand something. There's a reason why Chaos was the co-host for the Anime Addict with Degenerate Weeb. Chaos is definitely more of a slice-of-life rom-com, like, that sort of slow-paced anime. He's a huge fan of that stuff, and it's great. It's amazing. He's recommended some amazing animes to me, to Degenerate Weeb. We talk about it all the time. As far as, like, Degenerate Weeb goes, he's more into, like, you know, it's Degenerate, it's DW. He's an absolute psychopath. He I don't care if he sees this in the edit. Just screw yourself. He's in the harem animes. He fought hard for that freaking interspecies reviewers. Y'all saw that freaking video. If y'all ever saw that video, I'm sure he'll upload it at some point. I'll look for it and upload it myself if I have to. So he's an absolute weirdo with that stuff. So he's into all that stuff. But me, personally, oh, I freaking love action, dude. My Hero Academia, One Piece. Oh, Chainsaw Man! Oh, actually, Degenerate Weeb is probably way more into Chainsaw Man than I am, but, you know, it's still a good anime. I liked it a lot. Demon Slayer! Yes! Oh, Demon Slayer! I freaking love it. Cowboy Bebop! Oh, dude, these are all amazing! Sailor Moon, also a big fan of Sailor Moon. I love it. Oh, I freaking love Sailor Moon. So, yeah, I freaking love, like, all that kind of stuff. So, if you're able to get me, as someone who's, like, just, I get so bored of freaking rom-coms and slice of life. I just can't, dude. I'm not about that. I need action. I need demons getting their heads cut off. I need fire. I need gunfire. I need suspense. I need something. I need a bounty hunter. I need space. I need spaceships. I need, you know, something. Give me something. So if you're actually able to get my attention, like Love is War or Kaguya-sama with Chika and, like, some of the hilarious, like, the Ramen Kings of Tokyo stuff. Like, you know, if you're actually able to get my attention, like, that's pretty impressive. So, of course, when he makes something like this, that's a lot more suspense, thriller, a lot more, like drama and like, has that hint of murder, you know? That spice, that paprika. You know? It really appeals to me. So, I'm super happy about that. Love it. He was able to pull off drama, emotion, suspense, and just full on, like, what's, like, thrillers? Like, I don't know what the word for it is, but he's able to really get my attention with this. So I absolutely was incredibly impressed with the creator.
And I'd love to see him do something like that one day, but in this series specifically, it's the contrast between the light and
the darkness. I'd like to see him do something a little bit more action.
And enhances both aspects of the story. Well, that's what makes the series, like, drama work.
Like, I would like him to do something a little bit more action, like setting, but I'd still like it to be, like, his flavor. I would like him to keep his flavor. I'm thinking something more like, I would not mind seeing him doing something a little bit more like, I don't know. I'll think of the most generic thing I can think of, like Samurai Champloo, you know? Like, I'm not saying Samurai Champloo's a generic, one of my favorite animes of all time, but I'm saying, like, you know, just a simple story of a samurai who's traveling, like, you know, something that's in a more action-y setting, but still bring in the comedy, something like that. I'd like to see him do something that's, like, more that, you know? Or maybe even, like, it doesn't necessarily have to be something like that. It could be, like, the story of a police officer, something like that. Keep it more in that mysteries, drama vibe setting, you know? L.A. Noir style. Some. Cowboy Bebop, you know? Some L.A. Noir.
At least. And I think that dramatic...
Love this girl. I freaking... Oh, that's waifu right here. Oh, with the horns. I love it.
Balance by its...
I love everything about her.
itself would be enough to make this a very satisfying anime. But what takes it to the next level and kept me coming back week to week is the well-researched insight this anime offers into the inner workings of Japan's entertainment world. Fascinating facts gleaned from interviews with actors, idols, producers, YouTubers, streamers, and so on that Akasaka and co-author Mengo Yokoyari know, as well as their personal experiences navigating the manga business and seeing their work adapted to film and TV.
Dude, I'll be completely honest with you. I feel like, and it's been like this for the longest time, and it's one of those things that I constantly say to myself, eventually, once I'm in a bit more of a stable situation, I gotta get it, like, and take this advice from someone at 27 years of age who's getting into this, like, fairly recently, and has been doing this for a while, even though I haven't really, like, gone anywhere, like, crazy with it. Like, if you're gonna start working, if you're gonna get a job, do something in the field that you want. Do not, you're never, ever, ever gonna go to McDonald's and get a job there, and then later on get a job in the field, and later on start to suddenly get an acting job, or suddenly get a this, or suddenly get a that. Like, no. Go get a job in the field. Like, do everything in your power to get a job somewhere in any kind of way related to what you want to do. Even like if you want to be a VTuber and you work at, like, I don't know, Crunchyroll selling figures, or you work at, like, an anime figure shop selling figures, like, any, as long as it's related to it, like, where you can just have it, be around it constantly and have it in your life. Trust me, it'll make all the difference in the world. You'll be much happier in your day-to-day life, because you'll be around things that you enjoy. And it's one of the biggest regrets I had. It's one of those situations where I am still technically doing it, but when I'm in a better financial situation, I hope to be able to hop over in good spirits to hopefully a job where I am more surrounded by, you know, I have always wanted to do more voiceover work. I've always wanted to do more voice acting, and, you know, stuff like this, streaming, content creation, filmmaking, writing, things of that nature. So hopefully in the near future, when I'm in a bit more of a stable situation, I can focus harder on getting into that position. And animes like this absolutely help out people like me who are small-time creators, who are just that tiny little bit of extra scared to get into the field and jump, you know, sort of like dip your toes into the pool water and see how cold it is. And so getting a little bit of insight like this can genuinely help some of those nerves that you might get and sort of be a little bit more open to the idea of getting out of your comfort zone, so to speak.
That's one of the most interesting parts of the movie,
too. You know, apply
too,
for the job.
Maybe not so surprising fact that most idols don't get paid very well and have terrible job security, to more interesting nuances of the business, like how a good performance from an appealing actress can get cut from a show because the agents of the co-star she upstaged have more pull on the production committee. And after the time skip, as Ruby and especially Aqua get into the entertainment business, the insider info only becomes more detailed and intriguing. I've spent more than my fair share of time bemoaning J-drama adaptations of my favorite manga and anime, so the way the Sweet Today arc dug into the behind-the-scenes politics and conflicting producer priorities that can make an adaptation of a beloved work turn out that terribly felt like a legitimate revelation. And as someone who...
It's freaking... The character, like, the comedy is genuinely, it's slice of, like, it is definitely his trademark, so to speak, where it's very slice of life, but it can get really, really wacky and out there. I love it.
You know, exist on the internet for a living. I found the way the show explores the dehumanizing brutality of anonymous online backlash to be very cathartic, though obviously I've never been through anything half as bad or even a quarter as big as what happened to Akane. Of course, that plot point did hit a little too close to home for the family of wrestler Hana Kimura, who went through something similar after a controversy on Terrace House and sadly didn't survive it. And to be clear, her family's Aww. Discomfort with that episode is very valid, and the Oshinoko fans who've taken to the web to tell them otherwise are absolute scum who could not have missed the point harder if they tried. But At the same time, what happened to Kimura wasn't exactly an isolated incident. Akasaka most likely drew on many different news events and private interviews with people he knows to put that story together. I mean...
Oh, and spoilers? I haven't finished! No spoilers!
Kana kind of says as much in the arc when she intimates that, you know, if there's 50 people who've actually done it, there's probably 10 times as many who've come right up to the edge and never come out about it.
Ugh.
And personally...
Oh, the negative thoughts are seeping into my mind.
I think it's really...
Just stay positive, my dudes. That's it. No matter what, keep doing it. That's why you have to... If you're ever going to start streaming or doing stuff or like anything in general, you got to go into it with the right mindset, I think. Don't go into it like wanting to become super rich and famous. Just do it if you enjoy it, and there shouldn't be another reason for you to want to do it, I feel like.
Good that the anime tries to get that point across. One of Aka Akasaka's stated goals with Oshinoko was to bring to light the pain that so many young performers quietly carry with them, inflicted by the audience, exploitative management, and the brutal nature of the business itself, while putting on a brave face for the sake of their works and their fans. But with that said, I don't want any of you to misread that I'm saying.
It's really cool, like, you could genuinely, like, take inspiration for your own careers from some of, like, that very first episode. Even just the grind and hustle that I have to put into, like, boosting up her own career over the years. Like, it's genuinely, like, interesting to watch and see and how it plays out, you know?
And
love
that this
it.
Anime is good because it's aiming to perform a social good. That's secondary to its quality as a story. The depth of Akasaka's research makes this a much more dramatic... drama for fundamentally the same reason that his research into ramen connoisseur subculture, analog game design, psychology, and what it's like to run a YouTube channel make Kaguya-sama a funnier comedy. Funny enough, that last point's also very relevant in Oshinoko.
Love it.
Akasaka doesn't just include all these interesting facts he knows about esoteric topics and different jobs for the sake of trivia. He uses the lived experiences of the people he interviews and reads about as a baseline for building his characters and the stories that happen to them. And because he's basing so much of his fiction in fact,
that is an interesting
to
know.
Yeah. Stories can...
It really adds a lot of flavor to the characters, a lot of personality and just real background to the characters, honestly. So I can definitely see that as a genuinely good way of like fleshing out your characters and really just drawing inspiration.
Consistently ring true. Anna Karina, whoops, sorry. Kana Arima is an immensely appealing and likable character in a generally archetypal waifu sense, sure, but her whole personality is also very specifically informed by her experiences as a child actress, which were in turn informed by the experiences of famous real-world actress Anna Karina.
What are the odds? Yeah, no, it was really interesting to see her go from, like, full-on, like, spoiled brat, like, non-stop tsundere vibes to, like, just a genuinely, like, bubbly, like, cool character. I liked her.
The high of the initial fame and the arrogance.
Arima, best girl. I don't blame you. She's an absolute cutie. I love her, everything about her. And, yeah, that whole, like, attitude change gives her so much character, so much depth that so many characters don't have. Like, people need to understand that sometimes having your characters change for the better or just change in general as a way to build them up, it can go miles in any story.
...that naturally came with it in someone so young, the drop...
That and, like, the fact that the first time we meet her as, like, a teenager, she's, like, so into, like, helping out Aqua that, like, it just genuinely makes her character, like, so much more charismatic and likable, you know? Something about it. She's helping push the plot along, so her character has so much meaning to the anime, you know? She's important. She's not like half of the shows that I've been watching lately where, like, there's, like, 20 characters and, like, only one of them matters and everyone else just sort of background characters just there for no reason, you know? Just a waste of space.
The overcorrection in putting everyone else on set ahead of herself to be easy to work with, all of that created the sweet, charming girl who's full of sass, yet fundamentally...
The key word here is depth. It gives the characters just so much depth that you're not going to get any other way, honestly, in like a natural storytelling way, beyond just the, you know, the typical thing that most terrible writers do, which is they just tell you that the character is nice, or they have some other character mention just how good and wholehearted and noble the main character is or something, you know?
Incapable of actually speaking her mind that we know and love. And while the series does wring some easily relatable Kaguya-esque doki dokis out of her obvious crush on Aqua, the first big moment where her character really resonates is also rooted in film industry facts. The anime goes to lengths to establish all the obstacles on Sweet Today's set, standing between the talented actress and the genuinely good show that she knows she can make, as well as how little respect her talent and the sacrifices she's made so far have really earned her, setting up a dramatic problem and helping us understand her stake in it as a character.
This is that's one of those things that I feel like anyone and everyone can relate, where there are just going to be certain circumstances where flat out, no matter how hard you try, you're not going to have as good a voice as this person, or you're not going to be able to do this particular one thing. And it's not for lack of trying, it's not for lack of effort. It could potentially be flat out just you have a particularly high-pitched voice, and so you just flat out cannot get a particular pitch in singing. Or the opposite could be true, you know? You have a particularly high low-pitched voice, and you just can't get a certain high-pitch tone. Or vice versa, you happen to, you know, be in a situation where you have shaky hands due to a medical reason, so you cannot be as good as what, you know, an artist as what you want to do. But as opposed to, you know, trying to make perfect straight lines and stuff, you know, make your own style, make your own path, chart your own course. Try to use, even if you have shaky hands, whatever you draw, you know, try to use it to your benefit in some way or another. Like, you just have to give it the effort. Keep trying, keep doing it, and even if you fail, you made something. And there are so many people out there who have made nothing, and they're going to keep wanting to make something. They're going to keep telling themselves that they're going to make something someday, and then they're just never going to make anything for, like, ever. Because why would they? They'd rather just judge other people on what they make than make something themselves. And that's just a fact of life. That's always going to happen. I was there at some point in my life, I'm sure. You know, what can you do? Go and create something, anything. And even if it's terrible, I guarantee you somebody's made worse. I can guarantee you somebody out there has made worse. The Room exists. Have you seen The Room? Have you seen The Room? The Room is a good movie. You've seen The Room? That exists. Trust me. You're good. You're going to make something that's better than The Room. I can guarantee you with the utmost certainty, Twilight exists. Like, come on. The bar's pretty low. Not only does Twilight exist, it was successful. I mean, the werewolf basically, like, makes a promise that he's gonna marry a baby, like a newborn baby, and then he does it. He goes and does it. He marries the newborn baby, like, years later. What a pedophile, right? Like, I'm just saying, that exists out there, and people like it. Like, you're definitely gonna make something better. Don't worry about it, my dude. Just keep making stuff. Keep making stuff. But we can all, the point I was trying to make is that all of us can relate to the idea of us being scared to not be able to accomplish the things that we want to accomplish. And it's a genuine fear. It's a genuine reality that you might not become the next PewDiePie. You might not become the next Markiplier. My only suggestion there, and I'm only preaching what I'm practicing here. What I am doing here is I am happy with my little corner of the internet that I have. I got 208 people on my crew. I love every single one of you 208s. And we got 50 followers on Twitch. I love all 50 of yous as well. You guys mean the world to me. You mean everything to me. I am happy with my little slice of internet here. And I am happy to do it every single day. I'm excited to do it. It is fun to do. And that's the only advice I can give to you is be happy and enjoy what you have in the moment. And don't worry so much about, like, what you might potentially have in the future or what you're going to get or how, you know, don't let the chase ruin, you know, the reward, so to speak. I don't know how else to put that, a better way to put that.
Character. So in the climax, when Aqua skillfully weaves his way around those obstacles, forcibly pulls a good performance out of the arrogant pretty boy and lays the stage for her to deliver just one genuinely great scene, we fully feel what that means to her. And not just for her.
Yeah.
Seeing the manga's creator react to that one good scene a little later hits home maybe even harder, or at least it did for me.
Oh, that's
now,
freaking
the
awesome!
Only context that we're given for what the-
Dude, spoilers, I haven't watched that episode, but that's freaking dope, I love it. And now I'm excited to go see it.
This manga and that scene mean to its in-universe fans.
Oh, was she the manga creator? Like, the manga creator of the anime that she's acting in? I love that so much, it's so
even
cool!
Even harder, or at least it did for me. Now, the only context that we're given for what this manga and that scene mean to its in-universe fans are the few tweets we read from them, unless we've seen Kaguya-sama, of course. But that's probably enough by itself. As fans, it's only natural that we'll relate to the in-universe fan perspective on the events of the plot, even as our insider info lets us see how wrong the fans are about most stuff most of the time. And because of that, the show's able to use fan input sparingly as a plot device. Gossip about reality TV drama heard in
past... It's actually a really interesting way that he uses it to, like, just give us, like, the layout of... It's kind of like a time skip, so to speak. Like, the audience reviews, reactions, stuff like that. It's like a time skip, where it's sort of putting into perspective the layout of the land, how people are reacting to the show, to, the like, whatever they were acting in. So you can kind of anticipate what the other classmates and what the other people in the show are going to be thinking about, you know, the current events, based on people's reviews of the shows and stuff. It's, like, really cool, really smart.
Sitting on the street can reflect our heroes' worries back at them and twist the knife on their personal concerns. A few tweets here and there can give us a barometer for how the current project of the current arc is doing and establish stakes for the performer's work outside of, you know, Aqua trying to solve the mystery. Crank the number of comments up, though, and suddenly the tsunami of hate and hot takes can feel like a straight-up natural disaster. And all that's very effective for helping to humanize the celebrity characters, but it also means that in the rare cases where we do get to see the personal perspective of an individual fan, it tends to have a really strong impact on the story. Like when that one old dude at Idolfest who was there for I way back when the babies danced gets carried away watching Ruby perform. A big moment for him and for her, as it confirms that her dream of being her mom's successor wasn't just
that's so cool
fantasy.
Though, that's awesome.
Course, he's not the only...
Oh, that's a big moment in the anime. I love it. That's gonna be so cool to watch.
Old school Hoshino Ai Otaku in the crowd that day, and Ruby's not the only idol.
Oh, and I love the little dress too. It's
even
so cool.
Even as her natural star is beginning to shine, and Memcho's YouTube fans cheer her on, Kana's there too, wallowing in her past failures and lamenting everything the other two have that she feels she lacks, which only gets worse when
Ruby tries to cheer her up
with that inherited brilliance. But then she catches a flash of white in the sea of yellow and red. Old man Aqua doing the same dance from
Awesome! Yes! That's exactly what I'm talking about, my dude! My 208, my dude! Love you guys!
And while, of course, he's also carrying torches, that penlight for his sister and work buddy, he holds Kana's color up first and highest, and lets it stand alone in his left hand. But in Kana's eyes, even that's not good enough. While Ruby may have inherited Ai's natural aura, only the love-starved child actress can truly match the orphan idol's insatiable greed. And that pushes her to vie not just for Aqua's heart, but the whole damn audience, matching the energy of Ai's original performance of the song, literally beat for beat, which takes Aqua's breath away, impresses the old otaku and his employee just as...
It's his teeth, though. Old Beaver Boy over here.
Original performance of the song, literally beat for beat.
The animation is so I don't understand. Like, the animation looks really nice in this, especially around the lips.
Which takes Aqua's breath away, impresses the old otaku and his,
in particular on the idols, let's say,
employee just as much as Ruby, and even catches the eye of whatever it was up in the heavens.
I can only imagine animating the dance sequence on these probably like is where the majority of the budget goes.
That smiled down on I and the twins all those years ago, which might just be some kind of visual metaphor, but given the supernatural elements of this story, we can never be too sure. Speaking of, we should probably get to discussing Aqua and Ruby directly at some point in this review, considering they're the anime's heroes, and, as a pair of reborn otaku, our relatable windows into that entertainment world. At first, they suffer under many of the same illusions about the business as most fans do, and ask the same questions most fans would, conveniently prompting expositional explanations of how wrong those assumptions are. They're also living a fantasy that many real Japanese idol otaku apparently joke about all the time, being reincarnated as the child of their faith.
None of that. So, like, this is a great point because of the, like, the simple fact that, like, anyone trying to get into acting or just entertainment, stuff like that, it's actually a genuinely great anime to watch because it does break down a lot of those walls, a lot of those barriers, a lot of that misinformation that you may have just incorrectly assumed, honestly, just because it seems like the most natural response to celebrityhood, so to speak.
Which clearly proved appealing enough to grab even the imaginations of foreigners who've never heard that joke. While the death of Ai is undoubtedly the single most defining moment in both Ruby and Aqua's lives, the nature of their past lives and past deaths does just as much to inform who they are and what they're capable of. Aqua was a doctor in his past life, so naturally he's book smarter than your average teenager, and he's got a lot of experience dealing.
I always wondered, and I don't know if we're ever going to get an answer. It'd be one of those things that maybe the author or the manga creator like might have already given an answer or something. Did I ever find out that this dude like unalived got by the dude? Did she ever find out? Like
people,
because he promised her that he'd be there to like do the delivery, and it was like a really cool and emotional moment. I loved it, and I thought it was so cool. But then like he was never able to go because he, you know, got unalived. Like, did she ever find out? Like, what was the excuse? Or like, you know what I mean? It just seemed kind of like messed up. Like if I was a doctor and I, you know, unalived after promising to be there somewhere, that would be the last thing, yeah, I would be thinking about. I would feel so bad about not being able to make it. You know what I mean? It's like one of those, like,
particularly
oh,
in
what is she going to think? I bailed, like, without a good reason, you know? Like, I'm sorry, I died.
Many times. But at the same time, he's not a genius, at least not in the same. He's got a lot of experience dealing with people, particularly in trying times. But
can I just let go of a little bit of frustration? Not even frustration, jealousy. It's mainly jealousy, dude. I have wanted this microphone right here for so many years, for so long. It's such an expensive microphone, though, but it's so nice. It's so good. It's so good. Such a good mic. But I have a great mic. I have an amazing microphone. I have the phenomenal, the AT2020 Audio-Technica. It's such an amazing, amazing microphone. I could not ask for a better microphone, honestly, besides the Shure.
He's not a genius.
But, not super jelly. It's definitely one of those, like,
or Kaguya.
That's definitely one of those, like, long-time goals.
Yagami. He can certainly play the part by employing knowledge and experience beyond his
unless Shore wants a sponsor.
Years and his peers, but by 15, that gap has already closed quite a bit from back when he was, holy crap, a talking baby! And his 30-something world weariness can even put him at a disadvantage to his fellow teens in certain ways, like how he decided to give up on acting before he even got to high school. Also, he had to go through puberty twice.
Yeah.
That sucks. Meanwhile...
Actually, one... crud, I had a point I was going to make and I forgot it immediately as soon as I opened my mouth. Yeah, no, I lost it. I can't remember what I was going to say.
Oh, his twin died as a teenager, so after the time skip, her body has already effectively caught up with her mind. Hell, given how sheltered her life was as a cancer patient with stars on the brain, like, literally, that's what anaplastic astrocytoma is.
Really?
Look it up. She's probably lived more life as Ruby than she ever did as Sarina. And that one fact defines everything about her. Unlike Aqua, who was tired enough of the old life he felt he failed his way through, that he was willing to thank the stalker who pushed him off that cliff for the new one he was living, she never even got the chance to try, let alone fail. So she fears...
Oh, that was what I was gonna ask. Did they ever... Y'all remember the adoptive, like, mom? The one that, that married the agency, like, head? That, like, went missing? Which, that's a whole other thing. Did they ever explain what happened to that guy? He just sort of went missing after I, like, was gone. Like, what happened to him? Anyhow, they ever explain, like, when they were babies and they were telling What's-Her-Face that they were, like, demons or whatever, or ghosts or deities? Did they ever, like, they never, like, went back to that again? Y'all remember that?
Not trying far more than failure. And that kind of makes her invincible. I was the brightest light in both of their lives, but in Dr. Goto's case, that was because he'd kind of checked out, especially after he failed to save Sarina. But for her...
Death Note is absolutely a great anime. Absolute top tier as well. Not gonna lie, it's great.
Her, I represented something aspirational. Someone who could vicariously touch the stars beyond her hospital window for her. Reincarnation is a second chance for the both of them, but only Ruby, whose life was essentially over before it began, is really ready to take it on. For Aqua, who got...
Well, yeah, Aqua's, like, freaking done with it. He's like, this is my second go-around. You know what I mean? She effectively got a do-over on a bad hand. He played it out.
So used to going through the motions...
He was done.
...like he was already dead that he panicked about getting back to work when he was dying. All that matters is being with the only person who gave that old life meaning, I. So when I dies, he's back to feeling like... He may as well, too. And it's only the thought of taking vengeance.
Like, he fully is ready to, like, just gut somebody and go to jail or, like, end it right then and there. Like, he's like, screw it. I already lived the full life the first time. This time I just want revenge and be done with it. Like, I'm done. I'm out.
Vengeance on the man who took her from him that keeps him going. Not even finding out why he did it. What we already know about the twisted world of entertainment kind of makes that much obvious. Whoever their celebrity dad is, he valued his own reputation over their mother's life. And as someone who figured he'd be headed for hell anyway when he died, Aqua's all too happy to drag that bastard down with him.
The anime gets more hardcore the more you sort of break it down to its bare bone roots. Like, that is basically what it is about, and I love every moment of it. Aqua's freaking hardcore. I freaking love this kid.
For his sin. But of course, he's not in hell, and as Gotanda and plenty of other people keep trying to tell him, his life's just getting started. Aqua's surrounded by plenty of wonderful people, and in fact, he keeps meeting new ones through the jobs he takes on to get closer to the killer.
And that's exactly, like, one of those things that, like, you really start to think about when you watch the anime. It's like, is he really willing or ready to, like... You know, let go of everything and just give it all up, you know, when he actually does find his dad?
What's more, he's able to keep getting those jobs because despite what he thinks of himself, he's got a natural knack for the most important part of acting, intuiting and responding to unspoken cues. A skill that's only been enhanced by all the time he's spent working behind the scenes trying to convince himself that he didn't have a...
And not only that, but it actually makes a whole lot of sense. I think in the anime, the one of the biggest things that they sort of, like, show is that he's able to insinuate and sort of, like, read people's faces because as a doctor, you know, he has to sort of figure out whether somebody's lying to him, they might not be taking their medication, you know, there's plenty of charisma and, like, talking, communication skills, acting, so to speak, that you have to do as a doctor. And like they really made a really cool point about that in the anime, I believe. So I'm surprised he hasn't mentioned it here. Maybe he does in just a moment here, but a really good point that the anime made, and I really like that too. It really gave Aqua a sense of like, okay, yeah, it makes sense. You know, he's been reincarnated. He has all those life skills and stuff.
Future in acting. And that's not even getting into his skill for impressions, which we repeatedly see is so good it can fool both his own twin sister and the girl who has a crush on him. Compare that to Ruby, who's got natural charisma for days and has become an incredible dancer, driven purely by the joy of finally having a body that can move like she wants it to, but who also still can't sing for crap after a lot of practice.
I do love that bit. You just can't sing at all. Like, there's a whole montage that I freaking love where they're just trying to figure out, like, what's the best way to make her popular? She's just garbage and everything.
And has to give up being the center just to give her idol unit a shot at success. With his skills, if Aqua just had Ruby's positive attitude, he could seize a life for himself that most people only dream of. But of course, it's the fact that he can't see that he's so pessimistic, willing to throw everything away and even exploit those wonderful people like Akane in pursuit of his vengeance, that makes him so compelling as a tragic hero.
That's the worst part, is that the more he does it, the more you're like, yes. You're like Palpatine. That this anime literally turns you into Palpatine. You're just like, yes, yes, let your anger define your actions, young one. Assert your authority.
Hero. And the contrast only makes Ruby shine brighter. Well, maybe it's not quite right to say he'd throw everything away. Aqua's love for his sister and for Kana, which seems to be somewhat tied up in his lingering escapist passions as an idol otaku, do give him something to care about beyond revenge. He even takes time away from his quest to help their careers along, and even when he's on set...
See? Simping does save lives.
...at working toward his goals, he can't help, well, being helpful to those he sees struggling, like Kana on the set of Sweet Today and Akane on Love Now. He may not be a doctor anymore, but he hasn't forgotten his oaths, no matter how much he lies to himself and others. And that might just be what saves him from the whole two graves fate we were talking about earlier. Or it might make it that much harder to take when he does finally leave Ruby and Kana behind at the point of no return. But no matter how his journey ends, I am more than hooked enough at this point to want to see it all the way through. And we do already have some hints as to where it's heading next. While it certainly ties everything together on a very satisfying note with B. Komachi's first performance, the finale also lays the stage for the events of Season 2, which will be centered on a 2.5D stage play
I do have to admit one thing. I find it very weird that like the color schemes for like the idols, like how is the girl with the red hair the white, like, light? You get me? But sure.
Much hyped yaoi baby.
But I get it. You know, Aqua has the
blade and performed by Lol.
Aqua, I mean not Aqua. Freaking Ruby. Ruby would have like the salmon pink.
Lol, the theater company where I almost certainly met the twins' father. So that's obviously going to do quite a bit to move the central mystery forward, and it will no doubt be very educational as to how that distinct brand of anime-inspired theater works, especially for people who can't actually go see 2.5D stage plays because we don't live in Japan. Plus, it looks like it's going to bring back some characters from previous arcs, like that hack pretty boy from Sweet Today, who seems to be putting some serious effort into polishing his acting skills now. Maybe Aqua and Kana rubbed off on him. But, of course, speaking of Kana, the main event of that arc is going to be a clash of egos between her and Akane, who...
Ooh, gossip! Oh, the next season's going
to
be awesome!
...seem to have some serious past beef as child actors that goes well beyond their love triangle with Aqua. And I must have caught the director's pro-Kana bias, because I wrote a whole extra page of this script just analyzing the implications of their 2-minute exchange in the finale, but all of Akasaka's characters are ultimately layered and nuanced like that. It's the biggest part of why his stories are so fun to experience and re-experience. Nobody with a speaking role, here or in Kaguya, feels like a background extra. They all contribute something meaningful, and digging into their characters always unveils new layers about the events that have come before and tells you things about what might be coming later. And if I let myself get carried away, I could definitely turn this video into another movie just trying to pick apart all those little things that make Gotanda, Miyako, Kana, and so many others great, but I have already indulged myself with that bonus what's in an OP.
Yeah, I still think the only thing that pisses Chaos is so pisses me off that the Otaku Twins don't talk about the past. If I'm not mistaken, darn it, I don't want to be the guy. I've already had this spoiled for me by some freaking manga readers. That's gonna be, if I'm not mistaken, that's gonna be a major, major plot point, is them admitting to each other who the other person is. So it actually is, it's the reason why they haven't spoken about it is because it does become a major, major plot point later on. So yeah, that's gonna be one of those, like, they're gonna keep you in the dark for a while in the anime. I don't know if in the next season, in the next arc, there's a good chance in the next season that's what it's going to be, because I believe in the manga they've already revealed, they've already made that reveal in the manga. Yes, you can tell I the more I try to avoid spoilers, the more I end up finding them.
Which you should go check out now this video's done. So I think I'll let you and my editors off the hook for now. I'm Jeff Thu, professional Aka Saka simp, and fuck it, I'm gonna go binge that manga now.
Do it, my dude.
But seriously, please go check out the What's in an OP over there. It's very good.
Love it, my dude. Good stuff. Freaking love it. Yeah, no, it was an absolutely amazing, phenomenal anime, my dude. Let me see what some people are saying here. Oshinoko, fans watching the Love Now arc condemning people who harass actors for stuff that happens on TV. Huh, I wonder who that's for. Y'all. Like, what are y'all what are you yelling at the internet for? Look in the mirror. The only thing that's really disappointed me with this, with most of the coverage around Oshinoko, is that people seem to be forgetting Mengo. Yoko Yari is a lot in their coverage. Nominally, she just does the art, which is still huge, because the art is a huge part of what makes the series so good. But it's also pretty clear that she has creative input on the story. But Akasaka is, in a lot of cases, gets stole credit for the creative leadership of the series, which is kind of sad. Is that true? Anyone verify that? Looking at Akasaka and Yoko Yari's on ANN interviews, both seem to say that while he occasionally consults her, this story is mostly from him. That said, there's points when it really feels like her influence is showing. So is this like a Jack Kirby and Stan Lee situation where, yeah, technically Jack Kirby had like input to a certain degree, but for the most part it was basically all Stan Lee's like ideas and inputs going into it all. You know, so it's like, yeah, no, 100% Jack Kirby was definitely intricate in the whole process, but it was still, you know, it was still Jack Lee running the show for the most part. Ayo, be sure to join the crew. Please like, follow, and subscribe. And hey, if you like that video, you should check out this stuff.